But Chris, I want to shift gears. I didn't plan on doing this, but something happened in the last 24 hours that prompted me to do this. You know, I've been writing a book about an experience I had 30 years ago involving a polygamist and a religious cult that was sexually abusing children. Folks, this cult actually caused more than 4,000 rapes of children during the course of this investigation that I handled. And at the end of the day, I was so honored to lead a team of 70 police officers as we raided the compound and took 32 children into protective custody. And we like to think that we rescued them. But before I go any further, I want to just introduce someone, and then I want to read something. So I'd like to introduce Amber Dawn Lee, a beautiful woman from Southern California. She's an actress and a comedian. And Amber, just say hello to everybody.
Hi, how are you?
Folks, Amber, 30 years ago, was a child victim of a predatory pedophile. And I came to know her many years ago. In fact, Amber, I often remind you, our first meeting was actually when you were in a school in Arizona, and I came to interview you about this group. Do you want to share with anyone how you responded to the police when they came and asked you questions?
You go ahead. I don't know. I think I told them that I followed God's law, not the law of the land. Is that right?
This teenager, basically, Chris, tuned me up as an investigator and set me straight and sent me on my way from Arizona. That was an awfully long flight home after talking to Amber.
Oh, well, I'm sorry about that.
but we actually created a friendship over the years. And about 2 years ago, Amber called me one night and asked me if I could speak to her about some of the abuse that she endured as a part of this cult. I will apologize once more to this sweet woman because I wasn't ready to talk about this case back then, and I politely declined and wished her the very best in getting on with her life. But I couldn't get her out of my mind, and I kept going back and dusting off. You know how you keep those case files of major cases that you've handled, and I kept dusting it off, and I'd prepare myself to look into the case, and then I just put it away. And folks, literally, this was thousands of counts of rape of children in this case. It was a terrible experience for those who were there, and it was hard on the police officers that investigated it. But after a while, I repented and reached back out to Amber, and we went to work in trying to locate the rest of the victims. And about April or May of this year, we brought together, now keep in mind, Chris, there were 32 children that were taken into protective custody. In April of this year, we brought together Amber and a bunch of the children that she hadn't seen in 30 years on a phone call for the first time. Amber, share what that was like for you.
Well, it was pretty surreal. It was really great seeing everybody. It was, you know, not even 5 minutes in when we were all very childlike again and sharing stories and laughing and just catching up on where we are in our lives. And we kind of felt like we were like just a bunch of like sneaky little children getting to, you know, talk on a Zoom call when really we're just, you know, we're all grown up and have really moved on. So it's really been healing to reconnect with those that really understand, you know, what I've been through because they've been through it too.
It was amazing, Chris. And after that call, I talked to Amber because I had a special memory, and it was that she had had a very special thing taken from her in these cults. And without revealing the thing, Amber, could you explain why such important personal items were stripped of people in a cult?
We weren't allowed to have anything that was personal that we got from what was now the outside world. And if we had like a connection to it, if we really liked it, or it was a worldly carnal item, anything that could take your attention away from what it was that you were supposed to focus on, whether it be an object or even our clothing. And in some cases, you know, they would change the person's name as well. So just to really kind of like strip you of anything that you care about. If you care about something, then it could be a threat to the leaders and the self-proclaimed prophet and other abusers that are there that want complete control over everything.
So Amber, I'm going to ask Tyler to pull up a picture of you when you were a child living in that group, and
Okay.
just because I love the look back and the hairstyles and everything else, and I wanted to leave this up for a moment while I read something from my book. It was something that you shared with me, and then I want to talk about it a little. Is that okay?
Sure, yes, go ahead.
All right. So I'm going to kind of drift my eyes off so I can read this. This is from the book that will be coming out, we believe, in November on the Zion Society in this criminal case. And this is from Amber from her childhood diary. One afternoon, upon returning home, I found a package wrapped and sitting on my front porch. My sisters and I ran to see what it was. It was a beautifully wrapped present. I picked it up and we ran inside with it. My mother struck a match and lit the kerosene lamp that we had. Yes, our electricity had been turned off again. There was a small note, scotch taped to the present, and it said, "To Amber from someone who loves you." She says, "I was giddy. I opened it slowly and carefully. The wrapping was so much like Christmas paper, but it wasn't December. Inside the box, there was the most beautiful handmade Raggedy Ann doll. It was laying atop decorative crinkle paper. She had black yarned hair, which I felt was just for me because I had black hair. How did this person know that I was always self-conscious about having darker hair? My sisters were blonde. I wanted to feel like I was a part of and not different from those around me. I wanted to look like my family, but I didn't. The doll looked like me. She had blue eyes. She wore a dress made out of shiny satin with an apron and even lacy bloomers underneath. I couldn't believe it. I searched the doll for a clue, but there wasn't one. Just a heart made of string on her chest. Just a simple red heart. But I still didn't know where she came from. To say I was overjoyed by her is an understatement. She was the best thing that could have possibly happened to me. Do you think my real mom left this for me? No. Do you know who it's from? No. Do you think my real mom knows where we live? No. And I'm your real mom. I mean, my biological mom. No, your biological mom was a drug addict. I know, but the note said they loved me. Who could it be? I don't know. Isn't it fantastic? My dad uttered as he walked out of the room. Amber says, "I was smiling, laughing, and crying all at once with happiness. Everything in my life in that moment felt perfect and whole. I had no idea who had given me the gift, but it was just perfect at the perfect time. I cried myself to sleep so often, but tonight I wouldn't. I held her close. Someone loved me enough to do this for me." Okay, I had never felt happier than I did in this moment. Somebody really loved me. This demonstration of kindness affected me deeply. I always felt different. I always felt lost. I always felt uncomfortable in my own skin. I had an empty space that she immediately filled. Her heart was made from cloth, thread, and the compassion of a stranger. But she came as a surprise for me. She was very special. So, Amber, thanks for letting me share that. Tell people what that little doll meant to you.
Well, that doll symbolized a lot for me. She was a mother, father. She was a protector. She was my secret keeper. I was living in a very traumatic existence because of the choices of the adults around me. So I found a lot of solace in that doll. And also, I was, you know, with the emotional abuse that I also had, I felt very worthless. And to have something that came just for me with, for no reason, it was, you know, just not even knowing who it could be, it kept me more open to somebody out there does love me. I don't know who, but somebody loves me. So if something abusive happened to me again, instead of pulling that abuse more inside, I was able to go to my doll and be like, well, it's okay because somebody loves me. So, and you know, I cried a lot of tears into that doll and, you know, took her with me on a lot of journeys. And then we were, you know, in the group, and because I had such an attachment to my doll, and I was, you know, intended to be a prophet's wife as a child, they took my doll away from me so that I could not have any worldly or outside connections. They called them a carnal connection, which meant that the devil was, and the adversary and everything was symbolized in my doll, which that's not what it was for me. It was quite the opposite. So that was a time when I really, you know, I lost a lot of faith, you know, went into a very deep and defiant depression for a long time. Yeah.
Yeah, so Chris, from a behavioral perspective, if you wanted to break this little kid, what are you going to do?
Yeah, I mean, so thinking of the psychology of isolation, right? These are 100, and you know, I've got to say, first of all, before I even go down this lane here, Amber, good for you empowering yourself to get to this point tonight and to get here and just to share this, you know, share this story. I mean, I'm riveted probably like everybody else in here. Mike did not tell me he was bringing you on here tonight, by the way.
Surprise, it's a girl.
But so the isolation behavior of sexual deviant behavior, right? These guys, and 99.9% of them are men. And of course, the women are the enablers, and probably that 1% will also participate in the sexual abuse as a whole.
In our group specifically, the women were just as much, if not more, abusive than the men sexually towards the children. Yeah.
I'm sorry to hear that. And that's, you know, that enabling behavior and that violence of that sexual abuse to a child and to a woman is unacceptable across the world. And just the mentality, though, the mindset of, you know, these perpetrators, where everything is about taking your identity away, just as you've said, right? Mm-hmm. And putting you into a modified secondary personality box for them. And all of it is about their fantasy process and how they can get the victim, you and others, into this box that fits into that control mechanism. And so by taking all the things that you, you know, are dear to you, you know, and then isolating you from the real world, those are total 100% control mechanisms. But I do have a quick question, though. You know, forgive me, my curiosity is killing me. I'm looking behind you, and I see a doll up on the ledge.
Yeah.
What's the story there?
Okay, so
well, that's an interesting question, Chris.
Okay.
And it's interesting you picked that up. Yeah, so this little doll remained in my memory for 30 years. And as Amber and I reacquainted and started bringing everyone together to talk through this, we thought there would be kind of a fun little surprise for Amber. So let's just play that, Tyler, if we can. And Amber, you can talk to this after. And the reason this came out today was because Amber put this on her YouTube channel, so I had to hurry and talk about it tonight. She scooped me on this. But a few days ago, I had one of the other children who were in this cult and were victimized. She is leaving the country with her husband, and she was going to visit Amber, who she had reunited with in April when we finally brought all the kids back together. And I call these beautiful 40-year-old women kids now.
Wow. But, thank you, Mike.
Let's share this experience, and I hope you all enjoy this. Oh, we forgot to turn the sound on, I think, but we're doing it right now.
Can you show them the doll?
Not yet. Chris, okay. You just need to button your lips for just one minute.
You already
gave up the doll.
I'm sorry. I didn't know.
Yeah.
Okay. So we're doing this little video. This is for Mike King.
What?
He had a gift that he wanted to present to you.
What?
And asked us.
No way! Are you serious? No. Oh my gosh, I didn't even pay attention to what this was you were carrying around.
I didn't even have to come up with the nice answer.
Oh my gosh.
Yes, she's famous in rap
career.
No way. I have chills. Oh my god. It's just like her.
I'm not crying again.
Oh my god. She looks just exactly like her. Thank you. Oh my god. Oh my god.
The letter from the woman that made it.
Oh my god. I can't even believe this. The dress is exactly like the. Oh my god. Oh my god. This looks just exactly like her though. Like, I've seen other ragdolls that have dark hair, but they don't have like. This is like this Christmas kind of like the theme dress is exactly like how hers was. It's so unreal. Like, I'm just like, I'm shaking. I'm just.
So, Chris, there you go. Amber, would you show them your little doll? To Amber with love from somebody who loves you.
Yep.
And, I thought there was something really special on the front as well.
Yes, and on the front.
And maybe you could talk about that.
She's got her little heart.
Oh, wow.
And she's got she's exactly the same doll. Exactly the same doll. I think Mike even found, her name is Christine Ann. Which is like Raggedy Ann, but different. The same, but different. So it's like a full circle. You know, life is always going to end up okay. So, you know, it's also very symbolic of the things that were taken away from me, you know, as a child and in that group and in that cult from, you know, the abusers. And now I'm just, it's like taking back my life and being given a trophy for it. So, feels good.
You know, Chris, it was interesting. We, Bonnie and I reached out to the Raggedy Ann Doll Company, and they have kind of gone out of business, but they found this wonderful woman named Lucille, who for 48 years has been making Raggedy Ann dolls. And when Lucille heard Amber's story and read that remark from her diary, she stepped up and made that doll for Amber. And Amber, you know that we love you, and I'm just so proud of you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.
So what has bringing all these kids together and going through this process the last 4 months, 5 months that we've been going through meant to you?
It's been really surreal. I guess I say that word a lot because everything feels that way right now, but it was just mostly healing. I felt like I was at home when I was around the other girls on the Zoom call, just talking with them. Banter back and forth was, you know, fun and snappy, and I felt completely at home. It was interesting to me to just also see how the events of what happened to us affected each one of us in such different ways in certain areas, and in other areas, you know, the way that we were affected. Some was different, some was the same. Just, yeah, it was a moment for sure. It was definitely one of those like magical moments, because it doesn't happen every day that you get to speak with everybody that really mattered to you as a kid, because that, you know, the trauma and the FBI raid and everything was, you know, dispersed after that, thankfully. But, and we're all still in contact too. It was nice. Dawn came out here to visit, and I went out to Utah and visited and saw her there. And Laura and Andrea, we're still friends. And I'm saying all of their names, and maybe I shouldn't, but it was great. Yeah.
You also made a surprise visit to the neighborhood.
I did.
This amazing, I was in the mountains, Chris. I got this amazing video from these kids down harassing the old neighborhood. Tell them what that was like for you and how hard or how easy that was.
It was so strange, because when we were there, we were, you know, to admire the homes and to admire the yards, and everything had just like really fallen apart with age and time, and the world didn't end, and the homes are still there, and you know, there's a guy outside fixing his bike, and life is going on, and it was a really big, I told you so. I knew that they weren't telling the truth, you know, and that this wasn't the only place in the world that was going to stay in existence. Is that one small neighborhood in Utah.
So, folks, in this case, we charged and convicted 12 adults. Of those 12 adults, that represented 757 rapes of children. And the self-proclaimed leader of this group finally died in prison a few years ago. And Amber, what was that like for you when that happened?
It really affected me when I found out that he had died, because, you know, for many years I kept feeling like I had so much that I wanted to say to him, so much that I would say if ever, you know, given the opportunity, because I never had a chance to confront him as an adult. And then after he died, it was too late. But, you know, upon reflection, I realized just how much of a narcissistic person he was to begin with, because he's not going to apologize to me. And from those that did visit with him, all he would say is, like, well, the guards just think I'm so nice and that I shouldn't be here. And so the abusers, I think they keep abusing and keep believing their own lies. So him being gone, I did also feel a weird kind of a sadness, and I don't know what that was about either. But I felt like a sadness of, like, a now what, you know, still kind of a feeling. We were all kind of just waiting to see what would happen. And
well, for me was a defining moment in my career and changed the whole direction of my career. But as we've talked about, I never stopped thinking of Amber or the kids, as I continue to call them, and how rich my life is today because I get to talk to them. And their wonderful husband, Amber, who put together this scheme with me to get you.
And, Ryan.
this beautiful mother has excelled with nightmares that no child should ever have to remember. And we're going to have her back when we do the Zion Society podcast. And you and I are going to visit with her a lot. And while I talk about what we were doing in the investigation, she's going to be talking about what they were doing behind the scenes to beat us. And
we're practicing.
Before you go there, I have to know what you're got an acting career now, and you're a comedian, and you're living in LA. Yeah. I got to know what you're doing. Come on, let's get to that too.
I'm mostly just doing my husband.
Okay.
But I'm only saying that because he just walked in and is shaking his head like, at some point you're going to have to embarrass me. It is the comedian in me. But no, I was doing a lot of stand-up comedy before, you know, coronavirus hit. And, you know, right now I've had a chance to really take a real good look and reflect on all of the things that have happened and try to find ways that I can turn these things, you know, turn these magic moments that I'm getting, like with receiving this doll from Mike, and find ways to be able to, you know, do it for somebody else. Because, and also to remember that how important it is also for the adults of abuse, because when you turn 18, you're not in the system and you're very easily forgotten until you're back in the system or addicted to drugs or trying to survive in all of the wrong industries, you know. So it doesn't hurt to send an adult a doll. And I just wanted to say thank you, Mike King, for sending me that. And I love it. I love having her here. She has, you know, she has been, you know, doing this thing with me out here for, you know, quarantine. I have her sitting out by the pool. I have her sitting beside me painting. And you know, she's my little companion again right now, so it's fun.
Do you sell your artwork and stuff that people could go and buy some of your artwork? I mean, we'd love to put that, you know, put it in the deal below our YouTube channel, or you have a YouTube channel?
Yeah, I do have a YouTube channel.
How can we help you?
I do have a YouTube channel, and it's Amber Dawn Lee. So if you just go to YouTube and type in my name, something will come up. And another way is my Instagram is Amber in the Valley. Okay. So AmberInTheValley. So that's the best way to reach me. I'm stumbling over my words right now because we've been in this quarantine for so long. I've stopped talking to people. So I'm so used to being like out and about and talking to a lot of people, but I forget when I'm only talking to my dogs all day or my husband how to like speak.
So what advice or what has worked for you to empower you to get to this place where you can talk about what you're doing? You remind me of, have you read the book A Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl?
No.
Okay. Can I make a recommendation when you get a chance?
Sure.
Okay. All right. So that is a great book. It's called A Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl. And then there's a second book called The Choice, okay? And just real fast, Viktor Frankl was a survivor of Auschwitz, okay? And he talks about a therapy. He's a very very successful and very professional, or a very renowned psychologist. And he was writing the book when he was arrested. And he had the manuscript under his arm when he got off the train in Auschwitz, and he was walking towards the officers. And as the officer turned him around, the manuscript fell out. And he came out of that whole experience up here memorizing the entire book. And that is the book, A Man's Search for Meaning. Okay.
Wow.
I think you will find that book. I think you will relate to that book, and in so many ways, because I see reflecting from you this incredible light of power, okay, and this incredible gift that you have to give to the world. I think people are absolutely gonna you know, say, I need to know what Amber is about. And so you keep going. Right. I cannot wait to see some of the great things that are coming your way. And it's going to be fun to see.
Thank you. It really is.
So, A Man's Search for Meaning.
A Man's Search for Meaning. Got it.
A Man's Search for Meaning. Okay.
All right. Thank you.
I'm going to give you a chance to say goodbye to everybody with anything that you think would be relevant. But I first want to preface it with, if you go to Amber's channel, it can sometimes get a little on the edge. So just remember that I'm giving you a little pre-notice. I've counseled with her. She does not listen to me even today. 30 years have not made a difference in the in that strong-willed personality that you see sitting in front of you. Amber, anything you want to say to these wonderful people? Do you know there's 1,500 people sitting on right now listening to you?
Oh, wow. Okay, great. Hi. Just thanks for listening to the story and being a part of this show. It's really cool what you're doing, Mike. And, you know.
Frank.
Pardon me?
No, I thought.
Both of y'all.
Don't worry about my name. I'm not important.
Both of y'all. I'm definitely a rebellious soul. And I I think that I learned, you know, when I was in the group, you know, if it's bad, do it. So
you are going to be so fun to do a podcast with, and folks, we're going to be back. We're going to do the Zion Society case after the book comes out. So probably around the first of the year, Amber, we'll kick off. And once the book's been on the shelves for a couple of months, we'll go in we'll invite you and the other kids on, and we'll just talk through. We're going to have the police officers who were there on the day of the raid sharing some of the experiences they had. We're going to have folks that have an intimate knowledge of why certain things were happening. We're going to be talking about cult mentality and why people fall for this baloney, and how easy it is to convince people to do something that is just so foreign to them. And like boiling the lobster, it doesn't happen at once. I mean, or boiling the frog, I guess it is, where it's slowly turning up the heat until people are buying off on this thing. But the difference was you and 31 other children didn't have a choice. You were forced, you were victimized, and you were compelled. And it took a lifetime for you to work through those things. And I just will never ever stop loving you and thinking about you kids. And I just look forward to when we do this again.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you for all the you watching it also. So thanks.
Well, thank you, Chris. We've had quite a night, and I think we should see if people have some questions, because we haven't even given folks a chance to, this has been our choir practice, not somebody else's. And it certainly was choir practice for me tonight.
Yeah. No, this was deep, Mike. This was deep. And this is what choir practice is, right? I mean, I think, you know, we get a great opportunity to meet, you know, women like that who have empowered themselves through, you know, just an amazing amount of, you know, I can't even comprehend it. I cannot comprehend it. And so, you know, therefore, I'm not going to even try. But I've also known my friend, you. I know what this has been, you know, for you, and how you got to a place where you had the courage to accept some of the things internally to go after this. So God bless you too, Mike. I mean, it's, you know, this is good. I mean, Amber is just amazing. I mean, thank you, Amber. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Just so many people I know are you're going to heal them too. You're going to give them the opportunity to move forward. Maybe they're struggling, or maybe they know somebody struggling. I mean, just the FBI the other day kicked in doors all around the country. It was a massive, recovery for these children. And I think they pulled 39 kids just, or 32 or 39 kids just in Georgia alone.
Yeah. Yeah, and imagine that's in a state. Imagine, Chris, we did that in one little community, in one cult. Yeah, and according to the experts, there are 6,000 cults in the United States alone that are operating. Stephanie Herb asked about, were both men and women prosecuted? Yes, in fact, it was a really difficult thing. We'll talk about more in the book and when we do the podcast, but both men and women were arrested in this case. And frankly, we stopped at 12 because it took us several years to get through those 12 through the criminal justice system. And we couldn't keep making these children testify. So we eventually chose to not prosecute other cases and left literally more than a dozen other offenders who should have gone to prison free because we couldn't continue to destroy these children's lives. So was Zion another offshoot of LDS? Zion is actually a term that started even back in Old Testament times. And many faiths have used this idea of Zion. And we'll talk a lot about religious influence on these kinds of cases and the fact that it's really not indicative of the religion, it's indicative of the predator who prostitutes these belief systems. Dra Latina, thank you. How much we appreciate you. This, as Chris kind of mentioned, was kind of an interesting process for me to go through. Chris,
so how did Amber leave the cult? And Mike, you did break the case. So how did she get out after you plugged everybody plugged them all up?
So, folks, we actually had an inside informant who couldn't live with the fact that she was involved in sexual abuse of children. And we'll talk about it more. The book explains it in detail. I don't want to kind of give it away, but we had information that started to break this case open, gave us the opportunity. But because we were so fearful of the children that were involved and the magnitude, there were about 120 adults in this cult. Chris, we actually, when the case fell in my lap, the charge was, if children are being injured, we've got to move quickly. And we literally worked round the clock for 5 weeks until we actually served the search warrant. In hindsight, I look back and I just wonder how on earth we did it. But I think we were just driven by the fact that we had to protect these little kids.
Yeah. And, you got a question. What's the name of your book?
So we don't know the name of the book yet. We teased a little bit. It's going to be Profiling Evil, and then it's going to talk about this group, and the title will come out. We're going to actually, our producer has decided that maybe the best thing to do is, because we have so many loving friends on this channel, that we do a limited edition that we sign and number, and we do a first release, and then we put the books up for sale. And the book is written. We're doing some editing. And I suspect we're hoping by November we can get this thing out. And I hope you'll all buy it for Christmas, because it's an amazing story. And then if y'all buy it,
empowering story. Empowering story.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. It's not a story about the predatory behavior. Right. It's a story about these victims who rose above it and became survivors and champions, and about this cult mentality. But the way in which we got the confessions, I think you're going to be really intrigued by.
Yeah. So Mary D wants to ask me a question. Ask away, Mary. What do you got? What's your question? And by the way, while she's doing that, we think, Chris, are you Jane Doe that was killed by some guy who brought her from Mexico? I'll tell you, I worked in Southern California, and I had a lot of capers from where bad guys were, from Mexico, and then vice versa. I got to tell you, one of the craziest stories, though, it was kind of crazy back into, you know, shifting gears based on this question here. My craziest witness that I ever had was on a piece of plywood in a tree. And the victim was below him, and he witnessed the entire murder. That guy was from Mexico. When I got there, when the team got there, and you know how we all circle up, right, Mike? And, you know, you're dividing up, okay, who's going to do what? And I pulled the case on it, and I looked over, and I said to one of the officers in the circle, I said, so where's our witnesses? And he goes like this. And I'm like, and I look up, and here comes this little guy, puts his head over. He goes like that. And I'm like, you got to be kidding me. No. You can't make this stuff up. I'm like, holy
you
cow.
You cannot make that up.
He lives in that piece of plywood up in a tree. And he witnessed the whole thing. So there you go. Will it be an ebook, Mike? Back to your book.
Yes, we'll also do an ebook, especially for those overseas. It's just so hard to ship anymore. So yeah, we'll have an ebook, and we're going to have some nice things. Who sent her the doll? I sent her the doll. And I had a 71-year-old woman make that doll from scratch based on Amber's childhood diary. It was a real blessing.
No, Mary, you're not dumb in any way, shape, or form. And you're right. I have been down there on numerous occasions, and we've got some great stories that we'll share with you down the road. But so please don't think that. I appreciate your question. Thank you. What was the cult leader's name? You want to give that up yet, or are you going to wait?
No, you can look him up. His name was Arvin Shreve, Shreeve.
How do you spell that? I'm teasing. His parents must have been angry.
And the amazing thing, folks, was that he fled. It took us about 4 days to locate him. I had to travel to pick him up. And he immediately asked for an attorney. Because we had pre-planned and anticipated that might happen, we had a strategy in place. And by the time he arrived at the jail, he had confessed. And I'll just tell you one funny story, Chris. We had this judge named Ziegler who would have these little oxygen tubes in his nose. And whenever he'd get stressed out, you'd see him reach down and turn up his tank to get a little more oxygen flowing. And on the day that he was sentenced to prison for the rest of his life, this predatory pedophile asked me to come and stand next to him while he was sentenced in the courtroom. And when he asked if I could come up, I watched Judge Ziegler reach down and crank up the tank. And so I stood there with my arm around him while we sent him to prison for the rest of his life. The only sad thing is that there weren't 757 life sentences for him to serve. So, yeah.
And you know, that's a good point, Mike, because you know, well, let's answer this question first. Who sent the original doll?
Yeah, O'Malley girl. We never found out who sent the original one. She never found out. The thing that was the message for Amber was that somebody loved her. And it could have been someone in the neighborhood. It could have been her mother. She was not living with her mother, who was addicted to drugs and eventually made some really poor additional choices in her life. And this beautiful little Amber was actually, Chris, her birth name was Cannabis. Her mother was into drugs, and that's her birth name. So if you look at that little video, if you replay it, folks, you'll see Amber has a little Cannabis on there, which she wears to just remind her of where her roots are. And she's not afraid of the fact that she came from a mom who was really struggling. So
yeah,
the age range, the age range was from 2 to 64 that were in the polygamous group. They were called sister councils, that people were in being sexually abused in. So the ranges were horrid.
Boy. You know, but I want to just back up for a second to a point you just kind of glossed over. But guys, let me tell you something about Mike King. This goes to show you, you know, his character. And by the way, I don't find any guile in this man. I have known this man a very long time. And if you haven't seen,
people say this about him.
You know, the worst of things in life, right, which we know a lot of us have, all of us. But to have that type of gift to where you're not only empathetic to the victim,
is that bad?
But you're also getting letters
funny, right?
From the perpetrators, from the prison. Huh? That is justice and mercy balance.
They all like it.
And that's why Lady Liberty or Lady Justice wears a blindfold. And you know, God bless you, Mike. I mean, you really are the real deal. And you know, that is, it's just such an honor to be your friend all these years. But to, you know, when we see, you know, these victims that you, these kind of cases that you worked, and then we hear their stories and we hear them say to you, you know, thank you. I love you. I care about you. But then on the other side, I hear you say, yeah, and I had my arm around that guy. I wish he would have been sentenced for 99 years, but I was right next to him when it was happening. You know, folks, that's why Mike King did this channel. And I am so grateful that he asked me to be a part of it. And, you know, good for you, Mike. Keep going. Keep plowing through. That's amazing.
You were the example for me. Thank you. So do we have a few more questions, Chris?
Yep.
I mean, we've already blown your night, folks. We may as well go until 9, right?
Yeah, we might as well roll. Well, we've got a lot coming this week, Mike. We can bounce into some of that, too. Oh, is Amber's mom still
alive? No, she's not. In fact, maybe when Amber comes back, we'll have her talk about a little sweet little gift that she put on her mom's chest in her coffin. And it will be kind of something that will tie a lot of things together. But
okay, so I'm going to kind of give everybody a little level set here over the next couple of days, because
this is big. This is big, folks.
Thursday's going to be like nuts, okay, in a very good way, okay? So first of all, I will tell you there are some big things coming in the Morphe case, and there are, you know, Lauren's on it. She's got a big series coming up here. Okay, that's the first thing coming, and we will give you a heads up that we know about it, but we are sworn to secrecy, and but it's going to be a you know, what did we used to say, you know, emergency traffic only. I'm kicking the door, and you throw the flashbang.
Hi, Don.